shall sorrow no more, not a sigh for the blessings of rest. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet
kertas, by and by,
kertas, we shall meet on that beautiful shore.
Pray first.
What? All right, our next song is going to be 216. 216, when the roll is called up yonder.
Next song's going to be 184. 184.
184?
Yeah. Jesus paid it all.
Okay.
184.
Thank you.
Jesus paid all.
Our next song is going to be page 12, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee, hymn number 12.
Where is Miss White? Miss White is doing opening, but she's not here. Welcome, Mr. We're just going to keep singing. Do you know this one? Yeah, it's easy.
Stand for our theme song, Sweet Sweet Spirit 262.
There's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place, and I know that it's the spirit of the Lord. There are sweet expressions on each face.
You may be seated. Oh, please remain stand. Sorry.
Good morning. Our opening song is number 343. I will sing of my Redeemer. I will
purchase me on the cross. He sealed my
sing of my Redeemer and the heavenly love to me. He from death to life had brought me, Son of God, with him to be. Sing, oh sing of my Redeemer, with the blood he purchased me. On the cross he sealed my pardon, paid the debt, and made me free. Amen. We're going to invite Miss Alyssa up, and she's going to come and have our prayer and our scripture reading.
All right, let's bow our heads for prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for this Sabbath day that you have blessed us with. And we ask that your presence will be here with us. Fill us with your Holy Spirit, Lord. And may our worship be acceptable in your sight. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Our scripture reading is found in the book of Galatians. Galatians chapter 3, verse 27. Galatians chapter 3, verse 27. When you are there, please say amen. Galatians chapter 3, verse 27. And it reads, "For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ." May the Lord bless the reading of his word.
Happy Sabbath again. It is always a privilege to be in the house of the Lord. At this time, we're going to invite Bianca up, and she is going to give us our mission story.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, church. Our mission story is about seeing God, and it's about Jacques. More than anything, Jacques wanted to pass university exam, entrance exam in the West African country of Cameroon, but the second half of the exam fell on the Sabbath. "I'm a Seventh-day Adventist," Jacques told the teacher who administered the exam on Friday and Saturday at this testing center just outside Cameroon capital, Yaounde. "I can take my exam on the Sabbath. Just come and take the exam," said one teacher. "You have to take them," said another. "No," Jacques said. "I want you to know that if you don't see me tomorrow, it's because I'm at church."
Some teachers saw it as a challenge. Mockingly, they called him a priest. "We'll fail if you don't come, priest," a teacher said. Jacques returned home. He had given his heart to Jesus in baptism a year earlier, and he was determined to honor the Lord of the Sabbath. He decided to fast and pray during the Sabbath hours. On Sabbath, he went to church instead of the testing center. After sundown, he returned to the center. No one was there. The exam had been given, and the teacher had left. Jacques returned home. Early Sunday, he went back to the testing center. No one was there. He waited all day long for someone to come. Early Monday, he went to the testing center again. No one was there. He sat down and waited.
After a while, teacher arrived and began to hand out exam result. At midday, the director of the testing center asked the teacher how things were going. "Everything is fine except the priest here," a teacher said, pointing at Jacques. The teacher explained that Jacques had refused to take his exam on Sabbath. "Let him take the exam now," the director said. "It's okay."
Two teachers needed to administer the last two exams. The first, who taught English, brought out a textbook that Jacques had never seen before and told him to read from it. As Jacques stumbled over the words, The teacher mocked him, saying, "That's wrong. You know nothing. How will you pass?" "Ask me something else," Jacques said. "Please ask me anything else." "There will be no more questions," their teacher said. "You will not pass."
As Jacques was pleading, he walked to the door to leave the room. Then he stopped at the door. It was like someone was blocking him or holding him back. He couldn't go out. Without looking at Jacques, the teacher suddenly blurted out, "Don't worry." Then he was able to move and he left. The next teacher was supposed to quiz Jacques on government, history, and geography. Instead, he said, "My gentleman of the Sabbath, what is Sabbath?"
Jacques took the question as an exam question, and he resolved that he would answer it well. "The Sabbath is in the Ten Commandments," he said, reaching out for a Bible in his bag. The teacher stopped him. "Leave the Bible alone," he said.
He said Jacques had been brainwashed and government, history, and geography were much more important than religion. Jacques replied that he had studied the three subjects for a whole year and had learned nothing that was as important as religion. "Religion is a matter of conscience that and can influence my whole life," he said. At that moment, another teacher entered the room. The first teacher told Jacques to leave. The exam was over.
Later that day, as Jacques walked back to the testing center for the exam result, a car stopped him in front of him. The teacher who had given the English exam poked his head out of the car. "Rejoice," he said. Jacques wondered if the teacher was mocking him again.
At the testing center, Jacques waited with the other student as the teacher called out the names that who had passed the exam. Then he heard his name. He had passed. He was shocked. He raised his arm in the air and exclaimed, "God, thank you." Jacques sought out the English teacher to thank him. "You don't believe me when I told you to rejoice," the teacher said. "He wanted to fail you."
"Why didn't you fail me?" Jacques asked. The teacher returned to another teacher nearby. "I wanted to fail him, but I couldn't," he said. "I can't understand why I couldn't fail him." Jacques was amazed. He couldn't understand what had happened. All he knew was that God had heard his prayers. God had honored him for honoring the Sabbath.
Jacques is now 56 years old, but he has never forgotten that day. "I have no doubt that I saw God," he said. Part of this quarter, 13 Sabbath offering will help expand Seventh-day Adventist education in Cameroon with the opening of a bilingual school where children will be able to learn about Jesus in French and English. Thank you for explaining, for planning a generous offering.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ashley and Bianca, for bringing to us our mission story. This morning, I want to speak with you about something that the Lord impressed on my mind this week. So first, let's pray. Loving Father, I pray that you settle my own thoughts so that your voice can be heard clearly to all of us, your people. We invite your presence again so that we can truly learn of you. This is our prayer in Christ's name. Amen. I would like to ask that you take out a writing tool, a pen, pencil, and some paper. I see the Sabbath school students brought their pencil and paper. It's okay if you forgot your tools for school this morning, because you can do the activity in your mind. And what I would like for us to do is to take an inventory Do you know what an inventory is? Anybody ever work in a store, did stock or something? A couple of you. Inventory, you have to do what? Kind of check all the things that are in the store. How many cups of whatever and how much of this and all of that. So this morning we're going to take a brief, not an exhaustive, but a very brief inventory of our character. So if you have your pen and paper handy, you're good. If not, you need to be attentive because you're going to have to make the notes in your mind. Here's what I want you to jot down. I want you to jot down all that is unbecoming in your character. Everything that is unbecoming, like, do I typically have a sour facial expression? That's unbecoming. It's not necessarily like Christ, so you would jot that down. Are your thoughts typically impure? Have a hard time focusing on good things? It's always running in a bad channel. If that's you, you'll jot that down. This is your personal character inventory. Those of you who don't have paper, remember, you're making note of them in your mind. Do you struggle telling white lies? Now, it's not quite the truth, but it's really not all wrong. You want to jot those down. You have an issue always trying to be first. You have to win. You have to be the best. Not necessarily humble. Yeah, you got to jot those down too. Everything that is unbecoming. So we're either writing or taking a mental note. We're not having cross conversation. Or maybe that's one thing you could jot down. Are you typically harsh in your words or your actions? You ever did a harsh action like somebody has something? Yeah, just give it to me. I'll do it myself. I'll give you about 20 more seconds to continue your inventory, making your list of all that is unbecoming in your character. You may still be writing, and that's okay. I want you to take a pause. And I'm going to be reading from Heavenly Places. It says, those who take the name of Christian pledge themselves to be true to God. Their actions in every respect are to be such as become saints. After checking your inventory, do you feel like a saint? All that is unbecoming is to be discarded, thrown out. When you took the name of Christian, I'll wait for the front row. Are we ready, girls? Thank you. When you took the name of Christian, you promised in this life to prepare for the higher life in the kingdom of God. Not a satanic feature is to remain on your mind or body. because our minds and our bodies are to reveal the comeliness of Christ, his purity, his integrity, his dignity. Isn't that interesting? Like a brave soldier, you are to obey your captain's orders, even if in so doing, you sacrifice your life. That's tough. Your mind and body are now to be treated with the greatest respect, for they are Christ. Day by day, they are to be improved. So every day, we are to be becoming better. That inventory that you took, all of these unbecoming traits, every day we should have less because we are constantly discarding all the unlovely character traits. And why is this? We are what we practice. Do we have a Judas here? Is your name Judas, anybody? I didn't think so. But when we contemplate, we are what we practice, it gives us pause to reflect on just what are we practicing. I'm going to read from This Day with God. It's called Practice Run. Practice Run for Heaven. Before I begin to read, I want you to take another inventory. It's not so much of an inventory this time. I want you to reflect on this past week, just this week. And I want it to replay in your mind. And I want you to think about every time maybe you were kind or showed tenderness to someone. Think about how many times you were obedient, maybe to the request of the teacher, the deans, your classmate, coworker, boss. Think about how many times were you true and honest? Anybody started taking tests this week? Were you true and honest? For us older ones, were we true to all the duties that we were supposed to fulfill this week? Hopefully you have them jotted down or at least brought to the forefront in your mind. Now I'm going to read from This Day with God. Practice Run for Heaven. It has become customary in many families with parents as well as with children to be more pleasant when in the society of others than in their own home. This is not the plan that God has devised for parents and children. Save some of your smiles and praise and courtesy for the home circle. You should strive to be tender, thoughtful, kind, to exercise Christian politeness in the home, in our dorms. The gracious spirit of home religion is to be cultivated. Christ never spoke a harsh or an unkind word. Mercy. When tempted by his associates to do wrong, he would sing from the Psalms or by some word of scripture would discourage the enemy. He invites you. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. When you feel provoked to anger, consider that in manifesting this spirit, you are not wearing the yoke of Christ, which is one of obedience, restraint, service. What's the yoke of Christ? Obedience, restraint. You know when you're making me irritated and I snap? No, I must be restrained. And service, serving others, not simply myself. It says, all who in truth are friends of Christ will do the works of Christ. We are so inclined to bring unsanctified, unconverted traits of character into our family government and into the church, and these make our words, our manner, and our spirit not only an offense in the home, but also to the church and to the whole heavenly universe. God calls it a perverse spirit. The idea that men can unite with the family of God with all their disagreeable traits of character unchanged in this life is the greatest deception and delusion. So if we think about practice run, we are what we practice. We're practicing for which country? As you think about what your inventory had on it, ask yourself the question, we're doing a practice run for heaven or for someplace else? I asked the question if there's anyone in here named Judas, and I'm going to make my final point here. Most of us know who Judas is, yes? Okay, one of God's, Jesus' disciples. Judas had the same opportunities as had the other disciples. He listened to the same precious lessons. But the practice of truth, which Christ required, was at variance with the desires and purposes of Judas. And he would not yield his ideas in order to receive wisdom from heaven. Instead of walking in the light, Judas chose to retain his defects, all these uncomely traits of character. He chose to retain the defects, his evil desires, revengeful passions, dark and sullen thoughts were cherished until Satan had full control of him. Judas became a representative of the enemy of Christ. If he had been willing to wear the yoke of Christ, he might have been among the chief of the apostles. What? Judas could have been among the chief of the apostles. You know, like when we think of Paul and all the wonderful works he did? That could have been Judas. What prevented him? He did not discard all of the uncomely traits of character. He did not choose to wear the yoke of Christ, which is obedience, restraint, and service. Very solemn thought. But in this thought, we see there's hope for us because we are still in the land of the living. This is why I always say that phrase. We are in the land of the living. We get to make choices. So as this picture is in our mind, we can choose today. Am I going to continue to retain my defects of character? Or am I going to surrender them to Christ and take up his yoke? And so when you, the students, my husband, my children, annoy me, I might think twice in my response and how I respond to make sure I am practicing for heaven. Okay? So I implore you and challenge you to take up this task with me this week. Take inventory, make sure we review each day. And if you don't like the character traits that you displayed that day, surrender them to God and ask for his Holy Spirit, because it says we can do nothing of our own. We can't even be kind. We all would like to be kind. I think in us, we as Christians, we want to, but we don't. We're not. We want to think of others first, but we don't. But by God's precious gift, his Holy Spirit, we can. We don't have to be Judas. We can choose to be Peter, Paul, or whatever your name is as you write your story, as I write my story. I want to be a representative of the living God. I don't want to be counted as one of Jesus' enemies. So, as I'm going to be taking up this challenge, I'm asking you to be my accountable partner. And when you see the traits that demonstrate I'm practicing for someplace else other than heaven, tell me, so that I can make a choice to choose to surrender, to discard these unlovely traits of character and be numbered among Christ's representatives. Amen. Why don't you bow your heads with me if this is also your desire as we get ready for our lesson study. Gracious Father in heaven, we're thankful that you offer us choices and that each day you promise that your mercies are new. Great is your faithfulness to us, in spite of our unfaithfulness. We're thankful that your word does not lie and it is efficacious. It will do what it was sent out to do as we choose to surrender and allow you to do the work in us. Recognizing that on our own we can do nothing, but by your Spirit there is nothing impossible to us and for us. And so today we're asking for more of your Holy Spirit to allow his grace to be demonstrated in our life as we become courteous, kind, loving Christians that will be demonstrated in words and actions to each other and to all that we come in contact with. This is our prayer. With forgiveness we pray. Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord for that message. Ron? All right. Our title for our Sabbath School lesson this week is God's Mission to Us, Part 1. As we begin, I'd just like to offer a word of prayer that it may be his voice we hear. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to come into your house and to study your textbook. And we ask that you would be our teacher. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. Our memory verse is Genesis 3, verse 9 reads, "And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, Where art thou?" As I was looking at the lesson this week, and you know, usually try to come up with an opening thought, I realized that my opening thought was my sermon 2 weeks ago that God had me share, talking about the mission of God's people throughout all time, and this is what we're tying into now in this whole quarter about what God's mission is and how we have a part in it. And so if you have, some of you are here to hear that. If you weren't, either in person or heard it over the YouTube or any other streaming service, it was the September 23rd Sabbath, just a couple weeks ago, Everlasting Shoes. But as we're looking at this, we're looking at, you know, what is God's mission? And what is his character of mission, if you will? So as you enter Sunday's lesson, it talks about the fact God made man in his image. And as I was thinking about what, you know, why did God make man in general? You know, the Bible says it in a number of ways. You know, this people have I formed for myself, in Isaiah. And in essence, we find that God made man for fellowship with him. And that's the greatest cost of sin, in essence, is the loss of that fellowship, the loss of that connection with God. I want to read to you something from the book Education, page 124, paragraph 3. It's in a section talking about the importance of the Bible in education. And it says this, "And even greater is the power of the Bible in the development of the spiritual nature. Man, created for fellowship with God, can only in such fellowship find his real life and development. Created to find in God his highest joy, he can find in nothing else that which can quiet the cravings of his soul, of his heart, of the heart, can satisfy the hunger and thirst of the soul. He who with sincere and teachable spirit studies God's word, seeking to comprehend its truths, will be brought in touch with its author. And except by his own choice, there is no limit to the possibilities of his development." Just again, the purpose for man was to be in fellowship with God. And we find in, you know, 1 John uses that term several times, fellowship with the Father, fellowship with Christ. And I decided to look it up, the word fellowship, and at least whatever dictionary that Google works off of, had this definition. Fellowship is friendly association, especially with people who share one's interests. So if we have fellowship with God, are we sharing his interests? And as we're looking at, his interest is mission and reaching out. And so if we're to have fellowship with him, we're going to need to share that interest. But we begin with our text, Genesis chapter 3, verse 9. I believe I have a student that's passing a mic around. You may have found some volunteers already to read verses, but there are also opportunities for you to answer questions and participate. If you have a thought, something to contribute to the lesson, I encourage you to share. Genesis 3, verse 9, this is just after God, Adam and Eve have sinned, and God comes, verse 8, walking in the cool of the garden, verse 9.
Art thou?
All right. When you read it from the Bible, verse 8, and in the spirit of prophecy, you get the picture that Adam and Eve had an appointment with God every evening. And this is the first time on record that somebody got stood up. You know, God was there expecting, to meet with them, and they stood him up, in essence. They missed the appointment. And through this, we find two principles in the way that God handles this. One, man is the one that's missing, that messed up. God is there where he's supposed to be, and man is the one that failed to show up. The man is at fault in this break in the relationship. But the second principle is that God is the one who's going to act to restore that connection. If God didn't care about Adam and Eve, he could have just been like, well, they're not here. I'm headed back to heaven. Right? But no, he says, Adam, where are you? I don't want this connection to remain broken. And I will act to restore, to seek you out and find you and restore that connection. So the question we have for us, and if you have a thought, be ready to share it, says, throughout history, God continues to ask, where are you? In your personal experience, what does this mean for you, and how have you answered him? Anyone have something they'd like to share about how they have responded to the question from God, where are you? Now, God has sought out Jonah when he was running away. God sought out Peter, even as he was feeling cast away from God. Do we have a hand over here?
In my own personal experience, you know, I told the Lord, I'll go where you want me to go. I'll serve you. There have been challenges and times, you know, when I try to go my own way. Mm-hmm. But it's been amazing what God has done as I have been willing to go where he wants to send me. And, you know, in ministry, we've had some opportunities, and sometimes it would look like, you know, this would be a great place to go and work, and, you know, you could really relax, enjoy things. And through the impression of the Holy Spirit, sometimes we didn't go there. One place in particular, the folks, people told me, well, you should have taken that call. You really should have. You really enjoyed that, you know. I remember that there was a time we were planning to go somewhere, and the conference had offered us a place. And there were some setbacks and some things that just weren't working out, and we were very discouraged because of what happened. But later, as we look back, we say, "Wow, I'm glad that didn't happen because God is blessed here." Mm-hmm. And oftentimes the opportunities we see and the things we think aren't, you know, what we would expect them to be. And the other thing is that God has places for us and ways to deal with us that, you know, just like Jonah, you know, he goes there and has great success. Even in his success, he's disappointed because he's more concerned about saving face than he is to saving souls, you know.
Yeah. Amen. It makes me think, you know, Jonah's experience, God knew where to find him, even if he wasn't happy with the results, but he was in the place God had sent him. And it reminds me of, you know, both the experience of Elijah and even some Adventist pioneers who, Ellen White, used the same question. What are you doing here? That's one variation on where are you, is like, I had a place for you to work, and that was where I expected to meet you. Why aren't you there? Go ahead, Mr. Terry.
I have a question, Mr. Derek. Mm-hmm. When Adam knew that he disobeyed the voice of God, why did he run away from God instead of running to God?
Yeah, there's a lot packed into that concept. There's a couple things to realize is that one, sin messes with our perception of God, and Satan. You know, if we read in the Patriarchs and Prophets, we find that Satan convinced the angels, even when they still had opportunity to return, that no, God wouldn't take him back. And you can imagine that Satan was whispering the same thing in Adam and Eve's ear. It says, oh, you've gone too far. God's just going to come down with a whap on you. And, you know, in that also our guilt leads us to avoid that confrontation because the presence of God is uncomfortable for sinners. And so Adam was experiencing that discomfort as well.
So you're saying that Adam knew all of that, for the very first time that he failed, who put that in his mind to realize that God couldn't help him? Because apparently, if you run away from someone who created you and they had a relationship before, he should have known that God could have taken care of the situation. But are you saying that he didn't trust God enough to run to him for help?
Yeah, I mean, that's what we see. Until he realizes his error and God works with him. I mean, if he trusted God enough to run from help, then why didn't he trust God enough to not do it in the first place? You know, that he'd already broken that. Until God reaches out to him and restores that connection and says, I will put enmity, Adam's instinctive response as a sinner is going to be to try to get away from God. And that's the thing that we're all fighting as well. You know, God puts the enmity in us to fight, to run away from sin, too, that we have this, that we have like a magnetic repulsion to both sides that we're fighting. But yeah, you know, it's not natural for the sinner to try to approach God. That's why God has to reach out and say to us, where are you? We're not going to ask, where are you, God, without him first doing that. Anyone else have something I want to share? Brother Paul?
You asked, you know, how has this question been presented to me directly? And I honestly feel, God has put a burden upon my heart to do a specific thing, and I've been running away from it. He asked me to, I'm not going to talk about it, but he asked me to do a specific thing. And I feel that, you know, I'm running from that. You know, God put me here as his hands and his feet and his mouthpiece. And many times I'm just going from church service to church service, you know, getting fat on the word of God. And I'm not sharing it with anybody. And I feel that, me personally, that I've been running just like, maybe not in the same sense as Adam did, but like Jonah, I'm running from what God has specifically asked me to do. And, you know, I'm guilty, I'm just me personally.
Mm-hmm. And that's part of our self-examination, like Ms. Sister White was asking us to look at, may have that same experience to say, wait a second, that's one of the things that he needs to correct is obedience to the call of God when he asks us to do something, that we don't try to run away and find something else to do to keep us busy. Anyone else that had something they want to share? In that case, we'll move on. And again, if you circle back to this, you're welcome to refer back to previous questions. So this gets us to the point of God's initial reaching out. And now that sin has entered, you know, what we looked at in the sermon a couple of weeks ago is that God reached out through his people, even starting with Seth's descendants, with Enoch, with Noah, and down to Abram. And we get to Abram, and now we see one aspect of how God assists or connects with his people, even those that are participating in his mission, that are sharing him. And we're looking at Genesis chapter 26, verse 3, 28, verses 15, and 39, verses 2, 21, and 23. There's a common theme that continues to pop up here. So we may not end up reading all those verses, but if we have someone to read Genesis 26, verse 3.
Genesis 26, verse 3 says, sojourn in this land, and I will be with thee, and will bless thee, for unto thee and unto thy seed I will give all these countries, and I will perform the oath which I swear unto Abraham thy father.
Amen. So that's talking to Isaac. Genesis 28:15, he's talking to Jacob. This is when Jacob had the dream of the ladder. And it says, "Behold, I am with thee, and will keep thee in all the places whither thou goest." Genesis 39, verse 2. I'll just pull that up real quick. It says, "And the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a prosperous man." Are you getting the theme? What's the common phrase here? God is with his people. I will be with thee. This is something that keeps reappearing. I mean, obviously, Exodus 25, verse 8, when God says, "Make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them." And again and again, I've shared this with my classes as we've been singing scripture songs. A lot of the scripture songs we have seem to have this theme in that. Exodus 33, verse 18. I think it's verse 18. "My presence shall go with thee and give you rest." Joshua 1, 9. "Be strong and of a good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed, for the Lord thy God is with thee." Psalm 91, 15. "I will be with him in trouble." Isaiah 41, 10. "Fear thou not, for I am with thee." And even 2 Chronicles 20, verses 15 through 17, when Jehoshaphat is leading the armies out and he asks for God's assistance, and he prophesies through one of the young men there and says, you know, "You will not need to fight in this battle. You know, don't be afraid. Go out against them, for the Lord will be with thee." And so this is a theme throughout the scriptures as God promises, you know, to reach out. The greatest thing that he promises again and again is his presence, to be with his people. And that is his desire, to be with his people. That he wants to be with them and that he will be with them, and through his presence will bring all that they need. And so a question asks is, what are ways that you experience God's presence in your life? How have you seen that promise fulfilled to you? "I will be with thee. Fear thou not." Anyone have something they want to share?
Well, I talk to the Lord. I talk to the Lord all day long. I have trouble finding things. And yesterday I was getting ready to ask the Lord, "Where's my dustpan?" And before I said it, I saw it. He reads my mind. Lately, he's answering before I ask. Now, that may be kind of homely and inappropriate, but you know, he answers me. He's with me.
Amen.
Amen. Anyone else? You know, that's one great example. Answered prayers, especially the little prayers for little things in our life, is one of the greatest ways we can experience God's presence, recognizing that he's watching over the smallest thing. Reminds me of a couple experiences I had in Yuchi Pines. I was there in 2010. And these happened pretty close together. I was working on the farm, and I was also trying to, take care of a wart. So I was wrapping ace bandages around my elbow with something to treat the wart on my elbow. And a couple of things that happened, those ace bandages used to have those little metal clasps to hold them together, and I only had one of them. And at one point, it fell off the desk and bounced away, and I couldn't find it. And I prayed, "Lord, help me to find it." And as I moved around, I kicked, I think it was basically some Crocs or something, and I heard it rattling, and it had bounced into the Croc. But it was, after I pray that God says, "Yeah, here it is." Another one, as I was working on the farm, we were stringing twine up between posts to grow tomato vines on. And so I was going, running the length of it, and I got to the end of one row, and I had a little bit of extra at the top, I think. And so I cut it off, and then I just kind of hung it right there at the top, and then I was doing another row, and I came up, and I found that I was just a little bit short, and I looked up, and right there was that little bit extra that I needed to be able to extend the rope and finish it off. And so a couple of things, you know, where God's watching out for the little things. It's not, there's nothing too small for him to notice. Steps of Christ says, nothing that in any way concerns our peace is too small for him to notice. And so that is one way definitely you can experience. I see, brother.
I was just going just to tell something similar to what Betty Lou was saying. Dozens of times, and I do mean dozens of times in my life, I have lost things or needed things, and probably half the time that I prayed for assistance, almost immediately before I finished praying, I would find what I was looking for. But the other times, God still came through. We just recently came back from vacation 2 or 3 weeks ago, and before we left, we had left one set of our keys to the house and to the car. We had placed it somewhere, and so we'd have it as soon as we got home. Well, we got home, and we couldn't find it. We emptied all of our suitcases and got down to the very last suitcase. And I guess one of our friends was over at the house, or my daughter was over at the house helping unpack that suitcase. In the very last pocket of the last suitcase, there was the set of keys.
Amen. Yeah, I was looking, don't remember the exact reference, but yeah, Isaiah says, before they call, I will answer. And while they are yet speaking, I will hear. Somebody else had anyone wanted to share? It's Marlene?
I guess one way that God reminds me that he's with me, I call them petals on my path. And it was one day, maybe I was a little discouraged. I was walking to my vehicle, and I noticed all of this, just like confetti of little flower petals, had fallen on the ground. And frequently, I'll get little reminders like that, whatever might be going on, just something that brings my focus to see that God is with us. It might be a butterfly, it might be a beautiful blossom. And I don't know if it'd be okay to request to hear one of those scripture songs that your class is learning.
We'll have to see. Maybe we can do that as part of the music program. We'll have to see about that. But yeah. Yes, you know, Steps to Christ, the first chapter also says, you know, that God is love is written upon every opening bud, upon every blade of grass. And so, you know, every little bit of nature that encounters our path and brightens our day is a love letter, a love note, if you will, from God. Other reminders of his presence. Anyone else? Brother Elmer's up here. Give him a moment to get the mic up to him.
I just want to go back to Brother Terry's question a while ago. How did Adam knew that that he's lost? How it come to his mind that he was lost? I was just thinking, like I think it's an automatic. It's part of God's creation that once we sin, we're lost. Just with like the wire. When you take off electricity, how does the line knows that he's not connected? So I think it's an automatic. That once we commit sin, we feel that we're lost. Mm-hmm. That's why our lesson says that we have to be reconciled. But the problem is, once we humans, we commit sin, we run away. But God is calling us. So, it's normal. I think it's an instinct. I think it's part of God's creation. That once human committed sin, we tend to run away. So I think that emotion is part of God's creation. That God knows that when his creation commit sin, then they act that way, that they will run away. So I think everyone who commits wrong, we don't tend to come to that person. We tend to run away. I think that's part's creation. That's an instinct for humans, I think. It's God put it there so that God knows that who is lost. And God always call who is lost. So yeah. I think when we're lost, as I said, the lesson says we have to be reconciled. To be connected, we have to be reconciled. We have to come to God and ask for forgiveness.
Amen. That's a good point. Is that in the fact that it's instinctive. We break that connection with God, and God is the source of life, and we feel that. You know, Adam felt that. That's why they started trying to sow. They knew that they were naked. They realized something had gone wrong. And I mean, we see it even in, you know, animals. If you have, if you've had a pet, you know, a dog, you know, does something wrong, and it stays away from the place of the wrong thing. And if you try to bring it back there, it's slinking with its tail between its legs. It knows that it did wrong, and it does not want to confront its mistake. And even though, you know, God reaches out in reconciliation, reconciliation is going to be an uncomfortable process. And so we shy away from it. We don't naturally seek it. And only God's continued overtures of love allow us to reconnect with him. And that brings us to the greatest overture of love that God has made. Find it in Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 through 23. Matthew chapter 1, 18 through 23. So God, throughout the Old Testament, promised his presence with people, and that was a spiritual presence. But now he's going to take it even a step farther. Do we have a volunteer to read Matthew 1, verses 18 through 23? We've got Hiao up here. Thank you.
Matthew 1, 18 through 23. And it reads, "Now the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise. When, as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph before they came together, she was found with a child of the Holy Ghost. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privily. But while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Now all this was done, that they might be fulfilled which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, Behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God is with us."
Amen. So beyond, you know, just the promise of the Old Testament, God, the Savior sent, his very name is establishing that connection, God with us. That he steps in to share our challenges and to share the problems that we have so that he can accomplish that reconciliation. And then again, we're talking about God's mission. What was the mission of this Emmanuel? We find it in John 1, 14 through 18. John chapter 1, verses 14 through 18. Do I have another volunteer to read this? John's account of the coming of Emmanuel, which he uses the term the Word to describe. We have John 1, 14 through 18. All right, I'll read this one. It says, "And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. John bare witness of him and cried, saying, This was he of whom I spake. He that cometh after me is preferred before me, for he was before me. And of his fullness have all we received, and grace for grace. For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. No man has seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he hath declared him." This ties back into something I was sharing a couple weeks ago. We found that the mission of God's people is to share the knowledge of God, to reflect, to spread the knowledge of God. But the issue at this point in human history is that no one, or very few, even remembered who God is and were able to share that. And I want to read to you something from Desire of Ages that highlights this issue and why Jesus came. It's from Desire of Ages, page 22, paragraph 1. It says, "The earth was dark through misapprehension of God. That the gloomy shadows might be lightened, that the world might be brought back to God, Satan's deceptive power was to be broken." Part of that deceptive power was the whisperings to Adam, "You can't go back to God." And he continues to whisper that in our ears as well. says, this could not be done by force. The exercise of force is contrary to the principles of God's government. He desires only the service of love, and love cannot be commanded. It cannot be won by force or authority. Only by love is love awakened. To know God is to love him. His character must be manifested in contrast to the character of Satan. This work only one being in all the universe could do. Only he who knew the height and depth of the love of God could make it known. Upon the world's dark night, the Son of Righteousness must rise with healing in his wings. Malachi 4:2. And just another thought that I've found that really helps me understand why Jesus was so essential to helping us understand God. In English language, when we talk about someone having the basic knowledge about a certain subject, we use a phrase that he knows the ABCs, right? You know the ABCs of something? You know the basics of it. You know the beginning of it. You might not know all of it, but you know the basics of it. The Greeks had a similar phrase. If someone knew the basics of something, he knew the alpha, beta. And this is where we actually get our term alphabet. He knew the A, B. They didn't add in the C. But we also have a phrase for complete knowledge of a subject, using letters as well. What is that phrase? We know something from A to Z, right? And all the letters. The Greeks also had that phrase. And their last letter is omega. And so they would say he knows it from alpha to omega. Now we find in the Bible that Jesus is called the Alpha and the Omega. Basically, Jesus is the alphabet of God. And just as anything that we would learn in a language, be it English or Russian or Amharic, we have to learn the alphabet first to gain that knowledge. The same is true. To learn anything about God, we have to know Jesus. No man cometh to the Father but by me. And Jesus is the, in him are hid all the treasures and wisdom and everything. To learn about God, we learn through Jesus. He is the alphabet by which we can understand God. And so the question is, think what it means that God's love for us is so great that he would come to us in our own humanity. How should we respond to this love, especially in terms of mission to others? Does anyone want to share something on that or a previous question? I'm just giving you a chance to participate if you've had a thought that you would like to share. All right, Ms. White?
I just want to stress the point you're making. We were sharing a couple weeks ago at Sabbath school here, the very thought of if we want to know God, we have to know Jesus. And in the same sense as we're thinking about missions, we connected that thought to the song, So Send I You. And as Jesus was sent into the world to give to humanity an opportunity to know God and to become like him, it's the same mission we have, which is developed in that wonderful song that we sing, So Send I You. The same way that God sent his son and he demonstrated in word, in deed, in everything, how we ought to be like God, so in turn, Jesus sends us to demonstrate who he is, because it's only through Christ that we come to God. And so when they see our words as a reflection of God's word, when they see our actions, a reflection of Christ's actions, they are drawn to the Father, as it says in Matthew 5:16, let your light so shine before men that they may glorify us? No, that they may glorify the Father which is in heaven.
Amen. Amen. Well, move on. Wednesday's lesson, John 3:16, we know it well, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. We see that God's love even sacrifices himself so that his mission of being with his people may come to be. And as he is sacrificed and moves on from there, and Jesus is going back to heaven to continue his work for the same purpose of bringing his people to be with him, he says, Matthew 28, verses 18 through 20, all power is given unto me in heaven and on earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And, lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. And in John 14, we find how he intends to keep that promise. Verse 16, he says, and I will pray the Father, and he will send you another comforter who will abide with you forever. And he's going to dwell with you and be in you. I don't have the time to read, but in Desire of Ages 669.2, it explains how the Holy Spirit is Christ's representative, and through him we can be even nearer to Christ than if he was here personally on earth. That he, not just with us, but even closer and closer is God's desire. And so I encourage you, a question you can think about and answer for yourself. It says, in what ways have you seen Jesus promise to be with you always being fulfilled in your own life as you are engaged in mission? The reason I encourage you to answer that for yourself, the Spirit of Prophecy says there's more encouragement for us in one experience where we have seen God working with us than in all the stories of others. And so it is wonderful to share testimonies, and yes, it is encouraged, but the greatest purpose that God gives you a testimony is to encourage yourself as well to continue to work for him and to encourage others to find that God will fulfill that promise to be with them as well. I want to close with looking at Thursday's lesson and a connection that just reemphasizes the central desire of the heart of God. John 14, verses 1 through 3, familiar verses. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. This is the beginning of one of the most amazing passages in Scripture, John 14 through 17, the words of Jesus and the prayer of Jesus, you know, where he goes deeper into the spiritual life and a whole lot of things. You know, the Holy Spirit and everything with his disciples. And at the end of it, at the very end of his prayer, recorded in John chapter 17, verse 24, we find that this is still on his mind. Father, I will that they also, whom thou hast given me, be with me where I am. Again, that's the same thought in his mind. I want to share with you the fact that in the Great Controversy, page 636, paragraph 1. This is in the chapter on the Second Coming, chapter 40. It says, by the people of God a voice, clear as melodious, is heard, saying, look up, and lifting their eyes to the heavens, they behold the bow of promise. The black, angry clouds that covered the firmament are parted, and like Stephen, they look up steadfastly into heaven and see the glory of God and the Son of Man seated upon his throne. In his divine form, they discern the marks of his humiliation. And from his lips, again, this is at the moment of the second coming. From his lips, they hear the request presented before his Father and the holy angels. I will that they also, whom thou hast given me, be with me where I am. John 17, 24. Again, a voice musical and triumphant is heard saying, they come, holy, harmless, and undefiled. They have kept the word of my patience. They shall walk among the angels, and the pale, quivering lips of those who have held fast their faith utter a shout of victory. This is the mission of God, and this is the goal of God. We see it all through the Old Testament. We see it in the very act of sending Christ. And we see it in the mind of Christ as he's going right before the cross. That again and again, and even at the second coming, the central thought in his mind is, I want them to be with me. I want to be with them. This is his mission. And this is the reason why he reaches out, why he invests so much in reconciling, because he wants his people to be with him. The challenge is, are we willing to participate in that? Because remember, to have fellowship with Christ means we have to share his interests. Are we as invested in his children being with him as he is? I'll just mention the challenge for the week in the Sabbath school lesson is pray every day of the coming week for God to open your heart to be part of his mission. And also, learn the name of someone in your life you don't already know, a neighbor, coworker, shopkeeper, bus driver, janitor, etc., and begin praying for him or her each day, that we can share God's interests and be part of his mission. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much that when we were yet sinners, Christ died for us and showed his love for us, and he continued to reach out to bridge the chasm that sin has caused. And we just ask that you will help us to respond, to not let any of those unbecoming bits of character separate us from you. We ask that you will bless us throughout the rest of this service, that we may go forth filled with your Spirit and ready to work with you in sharing that knowledge, reflecting that glory to others. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
It's okay.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. It's good to be here, isn't it? On the holy day, the Sabbath day. I'm happy to see everyone. Well, I'm personal ministry today, and I'm happy to be. You might say, why is she so happy? Because we have a message to the world, right? What's our message? What's our message? What's the other message? Why? Go ye therefore, right? And teach what? Go, you know the song? Go ye therefore and teach all nations. Go, go, go. Go ye therefore and teach all nations. Go, go, go. How? How? Baptizing them how? In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost. Are we going? Have we been going? We have? Well, then if we've been going, our church should be full, right? We should not have a seat to sit in, right? I think we, God's children, are a little slack right now. We want Jesus to come, but nobody wants to work hard, right? And we love seeing people come in. Well, today I'm very happy because, you know, I'm a door knocker. And I love knocking on doors. And I've had someone to tell me, don't get up there talking about knocking on doors now. But I want to ask Peggy to stand, please. Would you please stand, Peggy? This is Peggy Lottery. Say amen.
Amen.
I have a story to tell you about Peggy. Praise God, she's here. Well, Peggy and I have been studying for about 2 years, Peggy? Probably 2 years. And she's been trying to get the Sabbath off. And so I told her, I said, just tell them you're not coming back anymore. She had to work. You know, some of us have to work to have a few dollars, right? So Peggy kept saying, yeah, I'm trying. And so my Sabbath school teacher at the piano, he said, when is Peggy coming? Because he met her. And so finally, I say, why don't you call and talk to her sometime? She knows you. She came to Sabbath school a couple of times. And I am a pusher, okay? Amen. And so he said, tell her just to leave. So I said, call and talk with her. He did. And so we kept on, and she said, I'm going to swap places with the lady that works on Sunday. Right? Am I right? Yeah. And so her boss would not give her the Sabbath off. We said, just walk away. Now Peggy has the Sabbath off. And now she's attending. And now she has accepted Christ. And now she's going to be baptized. Amen. So, you know, don't worry about what they tell you. The only way I won't go back to someone that I'm giving studies to, they got to actually open their lips and say, don't come back. Because if you don't answer the door, I'm going to keep on knocking. So are we going to be forceful and just keep knocking? We have to go. They don't know what they want. So let's go. You don't have to be smart to give Bible study. Did you know that? Did you know that? All you have to do is go. The Holy Spirit will be there with you. And you study your Bible? He going to tell you what to say. And you will get home and say, wow, did I say that? No, you didn't. The Holy Spirit told you. Amen. So let's go, people, so we can hurry and go home. I'm tired of this world. How about you? Amen. God be with each one of you all as you work for the Lord. Amen. I forgot to say, I have to say this. Peggy used to come on Mondays when Pastor Wendt would have his little classes. She was just pushing and trying, and she would go. Isn't that a blessing? So y'all pray for her because she's a good warrior.
Good morning. Good morning. Happy Sabbath to everyone. Happy Sabbath. This is the time that we say welcome. You know, welcome to our regulars. And we have any visitors here? Raise your hand. Amen. Okay, don't see any. Sometimes I feel like a visitor. Yeah. But the Lord is good. So we're just praising the Lord for strength and energy to be able to worship today together, and pray that the Lord will be in his holy temple this morning. We have a few announcements to make. I'm going to invite Pastor Bob up, and he has an announcement that he's going to make with some Bibles that are needed.
Happy Sabbath. Good to be here. And I know that several of you are looking forward to tonight when they're having the all-night prayer vigil. And it's starting with a Vespers at 6:30, is that right? Mm-hmm. 6:30. And so I'm planning to be here for that. And tomorrow morning, we're going to have pancake breakfast after our prayer venture. We're going to close our fast with some food. Amen. And so I'm going to be here making some pancakes, some potatoes, and we'll just have a good time together, fellowship in the morning. That'll be at 7 o'clock. All right, so, and I'll be closing out my part with at 5:30. I'll be here at 4:30 to 5:30, and we've got some really good experiences to be shared here tonight, so I hope you'll come and be a part of that. The other thing is Eli was talking to me as we were going home a couple Sabbaths ago, and he said, you know, in our Students for Christ, we have a bunch of the kids that don't have Bibles. So he has in his school a group called Students for Christ, and they meet at least once a week, and they share the scripture. And I've been invited to go over and share a little talk with them in November. So in the middle of November, was the 18th, is that what you said, or the 16th, 15th. 15th of November, 18th is Sabbath, I think. Anyway, so I'm planning to be there and share with them. And when I go, I'd like to take a couple of boxes of Bibles and be able to give out some Bibles to those students who are love the Lord and are studying his word, and be able to give them some Bibles. So I need some help with that. We need about $400 to get 50 Bibles. I've talked to the bookstore already, and we can get some fairly decent Bibles. And so some of you put it in personal ministries or put it in there in Bibles for Students for Christ. We need some money. Eli said he was willing to buy the Bibles, but I don't think he's got $400.
So
we ought to help him.
What about members who may have some extra Bibles?
Well,
they might want to donate.
We'd kind of like them to have Bibles the same, because they're in a group together, studying together, so we'd like the Bibles to be pretty much the same.
Okay.
And so, I mean, it's, yeah.
Okay. All right.
Thank you.
Yes, Sister Leonard. How many
Bibles can you buy for $40?
50.
50.
Yes, ma'am. They're about $6.50 each when we buy them by the case.
Okay, so donations would be appreciated. Eli is doing just a tremendous work, and we just really appreciate him and his mission effort to save souls, and at his young age. And so the Lord is using him as a true soldier. And so we want to bless his humble efforts. Just to elaborate on the pastor mentioned the prayer session starting this evening at 6:30. And for those of you who don't know, we've had it at the Savannah Church. I think this is the fourth time it's been at our church, but this is the first time that the Savannah Church has kind of orchestrated the program. And so at other times, Waynesboro, Adamsville, Bethel Springs orchestrated the program. We just had it in our sanctuary. So this time is the last time. And so if anyone is wanting to stay overnight or a portion of the night to come in and pray, if you have some special needs, special people that you want to pray for, or if you just want to join someone else and pray with them, you know, for challenges that they're having. The church will be open all night. As Pastor mentioned, he's going to close out at 5:30 or 6 o'clock, and then he's going to go flip some pancakes, you know, and we'll close out at 6:30. So the church will be open all night for anyone that might want to come in and fellowship in prayer. Okay, a couple announcements here. It was also mentioned in our bulletin, but I was asked to mention the October 14th potluck for Pastor Bob's retirement. That's next Sabbath. And so the potluck is not this Sabbath. We changed it for that purpose. And inviting everyone to, whoever can, come in and support Pastor Bob. And also, the women's ministry is in your bulletin here, but I want to mention that. If you look at the back of your bulletin, Women's Ministry Prayer Brunch, Sunday, October 29th at 10 a.m., and the sign-up sheet will be available for next Sabbath. Also, I was asked to mention the church choir. So if anybody is interested in joining or forming a church choir here in Savannah, then contact Sister Perez, Mary Perez, and just let her know, and she'll get you signed up and give you whatever information that you might need. And checking my notes here, I think the last announcement, we had a church meeting scheduled for tomorrow morning, and that's been updated. We've changed it to November 12th. Apparently there was some issues with some of the things that we were looking at, property. And for those of you who don't know, the meeting is for making decisions whether or not to upgrade or how to upgrade or expand the Savannah Church. And so we've had those meetings, a couple sessions now, and we had one scheduled for tomorrow morning, but because of some hiccups, and then Brother Richard is having some challenges as well, we want to give him time to, you know, get in line and take care of all his health needs and appointments. And so that meeting has been scheduled for November 12th. And she'll just note that, and we'll continue to announce it week after week, so in case someone's not here, they'll be aware. Okay, any other announcements? Anyone else that I've forgotten or need to mention before we start with the service? Yes. I'm not sure. Maybe the gentleman in the back can tell us. The question is, the session tonight, will it be live streamed? It will be. Okay. So if there's no other announcements, we're going to get the choir ready to begin. God bless you all, and may the Lord open our hearts for the divine worship hour.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, everyone. So in behalf of Harbert Hills Academy, I would like to welcome you to our divine worship. And we praise God that Savannah Church has given us the opportunity to handle this program. We don't have one speaker to deliver the message today, though. But instead, we will have message in the form of songs from Harbert Hills Small Choir and other people. We hope that everyone will be blessed in these holy Sabbath hours.
The highlights of the program this morning after my part, the intro will follow. We are going to sing The Lord in His Holy Temple that will be led by Eliakim, Tobias, and Uriel. For the invocation song, we will sing Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Then the invocation prayer by Tobias. The small choir will sing God Almighty Is, as an opening hymn.
The scripture reading and prayer will be led by Miss Lavi. Then we will sing Now, Dear Lord, as we pray, as we kneel. The tithe and offering will be led by Pastor Kenny. Then the children will offer the do refer to songs, I'm trying to be like Jesus and Thy Word.
The HHA quartet will sing the special song, The Lord is Coming. Then the messages and songs will follow. The benediction will be led by Mr. Elmer Decina and the response by the small choir. So before we will take our seat, we will read to you a passage from the Bible in Psalm chapter 104, verse 33.
We will sing unto the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praise to God while I have my being. Blessed Sabbath, everyone. So this is Anastasia and
Masika. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Happy Sabbath. Let us open our hymn and sing hymnal number 692, The Lord is in His Holy Temple. Stand up and sing hymn number 694, Praise God, from whom all blessings.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son,
for a prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for being with us. Lord, thank you for gathering us here to worship your name. As we're going to sing some songs, please be with us, and our song may be blessings towards other and satisfy your heart. In your mighty name, Lord, I pray. Amen.
Amen. Happy Sabbath, everyone. Sabbath. Our scripture reading is taken from Psalms 103, verse 1, which says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name." Before we pray, are there any praises or prayer requests? Oh, yes, sure. Amen. Yes.
I have a friend of mine that's two rows over, a Michael Street, a couple rows over, and they could meet a lot of the men. And they're extremely interested in the Sabbath. And he asked me, he said, well, what makes it so special? And he said, you know, you're supposed to go to church on Sunday. And I said, well, who told you that? When you're born a certain way and you're taught a certain way, it's very difficult to introduce the Sabbath to somebody that is born into Sunday worship.
Anyone else? Okay. Amen. Okay.
More than a few days ago, a few months ago, as y'all know, we did VBS, and a lot of us came over, a lot of kids did it and all that. And so about a week ago, a little more than a week, I was praying that I would get some money in the mail because I didn't have any money, and someone in my Bible class needs a Bible. And so I prayed that morning. And that afternoon, $40 came in the mail for me helping VBS. So,
amen.
I want to praise God.
Amen. Anyone else? Yes.
That's with a new great-grandson, and he is in Vanderbilt. He does have a few health issues, and we would appreciate prayers for him. His name is Archer.
Okay. We'll pray for him. Yes. More in the back.
Blessed Sabbath again.
Sabbath.
So good to be able to testify for the Lord. I always have a testimony. Spirit prophecy says that we should always have a testimony. Even if it's the same one over and over. Be thankful for what God has done. I'm very grateful and thankful this morning that God has me alive. Why? So I can do the work that he has said for us to do. I am thankful. I am happy. I have the breath in my body to praise the Lord. Amen. Well, yesterday, I have a conference line. And when we come on and we praise the Lord and we sing and we just tell God how much we love him. So yesterday I called this friend. I call her my friend now. Everybody that come to God, I call her my friend. And so when I called her, I said, how are you? She said, I've seen better days. It's been better. I said, oh, really? I said, well, why don't you come on a conference line tonight? She said, I don't think so. I said, come on. I said, we need encouragement from each other. I said, you need to just come on, and we're all going to be there talking about the Lord. Let me tell you something. We need the Lord. Amen. We're in terrible times. We need Jesus, and we need each other. So she came on. I was so excited, because that's my excitement as an old lady, okay? And so we had a good time. And I said, hey, Donna, why don't you come to church tomorrow and be with me? She said, I don't know. I said, hey, pep up. I said, the young people are going to be performing tomorrow. And she loved young people. And today she's here. Amen. And she's a new member of our church. She's only been a member for about 2 months. So put your arms around her. Let her know that you love her and that you're glad she's one of us to join in with the Lord.
Amen.
Well, I want to thank the Lord. I haven't been here in a while, but I thank God for this gentleman being here today. Last time I came, he had had an emergency here at church. And, Brother Gary, amen, amen. And we have been praying for him. And it does my heart good to see him in church today. So I thank God. I don't know you personally, brother, but you bless my heart sitting here today.
Amen.
I'd like to request prayer for my son's mother-in-law, Cindy. She's in the hospital on a ventilator, and so we need to pray for her. And I think it's from tick fever, but anyway, she's struggling. And also, like prayer for my son, his family.
Anyone else?
I talked to Wanda last night, and she's doing good. She's in Bolivar in rehab, and she'll be going home either today or Monday.
Amen. Amen.
Any more? Any silence? Let us kneel down as we pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this beautiful Sabbath day you've given to us, and thank you for the morning that we're able to wake up, and thank you for the good night rest. Thank you for the opportunity we can gather here together. Please bless all the prayer requests we have heard. You know them one by one, and even the silent ones, please answer them according to your will. And we want to thank you for all the praises as well. Thank you for guiding us throughout our 6 days of work, and we're able to enjoy the Sabbath again. Please continue to bless us throughout the Sabbath day so we can continue to keep it holy and solemn, and keep us all healthy and safe. In Jesus' name, pray. Amen.
Okay, happy Sabbath once again. I'm just going to do a quick sneak in to do the tithes and offering this morning. And keep it brief. Tithes and offering is for the local church budget. And so as I mentioned earlier, we've been having business meetings about how we could make the church a better beacon in the community, not for ourselves, but so it'll serve the Lord and be an open community center for the community, not just for our members. And so the offering that will be collected today, turned in today, will be for the local church budget. And I invite everyone to pray for those that are in the business meeting discussing which direction to go with the church and how to expand, and that we'll not run ahead of the Lord in any way. And so just pray for wisdom, you know, as we continue this discussion. And for those that do not know, we're not going to pass the offering plate, but at the back door to your right as you go out, there's a little cabinet with slots in it, and whatever offering that you're submitting, you could place it in one of those slots, the appropriate slot. So let's bow our heads for another word of prayer. Ask the Lord to bless our offering. Father in heaven, once again, we're humble before you. And once again, we want to lift up our sanctuary to you, our church that you have blessed us with. And we just praise in your name as we collect the offering today to enhance it in any way that you see fit. And we pray for those of us who are discussing it and making decisions, once again, that you would give us that wisdom and discernment that we need. And that as a result of our following your lead, the church would be a better place as we decide how to expand it. And this is our prayer, and we ask it of you in the name of Jesus and for his sake. Let us all say, amen. Amen. Thank you.
I'm trying to love my neighbor. I'm learning to serve my friend. I watch for the day of gladness when Jesus will come again. I try to remember the lessons he taught. Then the Holy Spirit enters into my thoughts, saying, love one another as Jesus loves you. Try to show kindness in all that you do. Be gentle and loving in deed and in thought, for these are the things Jesus taught. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet, and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet, and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid and think I've lost my way, still you're there.
Other members of the quartet are coming up. I'll say it's a blessing to be able to be here and share music again with you. Our first song, you said, as you see in the bulletin, is Lord is Coming, based partly in John 14, verse 1.
Praise the Lord, everyone.
Amen.
God is worthy to be praised. Amen. Amen. God is worthy to be praised.
Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God and in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. I go to prepare a place for thee. The Lord is coming, are you ready? The Lord is coming, are you ready? Would your heart be right if he came tonight? My brother, promises of God all are true. Jesus bought your life on Calvary's mountain, and soon he will come again for you. The Lord is coming, are you ready? The Lord is coming, are you ready? Would your heart be right if he came tonight? The Lord is coming, are you ready? The Lord is coming, are you ready? The Lord is coming, are you ready?
Basically, yeah, the song means, the song is Use Me, Lord. The song is was written by a 13 years old boy named Matthew as part of his God's life requirement. This was his favorite project. He wrote the lyrics and chose the basic chord progression. Although Matthew is non-verbal autistic, he has truly found his voice. Matthew spells out his thought on a letterboard, and it's in this way that he expresses his deep opinion, original thought, and seek to be a voice for the silent one. He took 85 pages
for Matteo to answer all the question and discussion items for God and life. According to his mother, this program has been a wonderful experience for our entire family. It's been wonderful to actually make the time in our life to sit around and discuss deep things like the question that were presented in this project. We are closer family because of it, closer to each other and close to God, in each our own way. Congratulations, Matteo, on earning your God and life onward. May each of us join you saying, "Use me, Lord."
Okay.
Next song will be Evidence of Grace. Does the world understand grace in the darkness times and in the good times? God's grace surrounds us like the air we breathe. When times are tough, we can discover God's grace beyond pain and as a beacon of light and strength, hope and peace. Yet every day, the greatest evidence of grace is simply God's forgiveness.
and we can feel his grace in the wonder and peace of knowing the Lord. Take a journey into the holy presence of the Lord's grace with evidence of grace.
Our next song is going to be So We Lie by Jonathan. So We Lie is a contemporary Christian song made famous by Worship Uniting and created in 2018. This song highlights the creation of God and reverence for our Creator. In the beginning, God created the heaven and earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of waters. And God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good. And God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was an evening, there was a morning, the first day. That was the first day.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. What's the first thing that you think about when you hear the word creation? And today, as Sabbath, we remember the story of creation, but we focus too much on the fact that the Sabbath was made to rest. But also think of this. Sabbath was made for you to remember how God created the world. And everything that he made, the stars, the trees, the animals in the fields, the birds, everything reveals God's glory. And all of them praises his name. So if the stars talk about God's greatness, if the ocean sing his praises, so will I. Amen. And that's the name of the song I'm going to sing. I'm going to sing it in English and in Spanish as well. I'm going to sing the first verse in English, second verse in Spanish. And I just want you to, while I'm singing, to think about everything that God made during those 6 days, and we can come today to this temple, Sabbath, to remember his creation.
God of creation, there at the start before the beginning of time, with no point of reference, you spoke to the dark and fleshed out the wonder of light. And as you speak, 100 billion galaxies are born. In the vapor of your breath, the planets form. If the stars are made to worship, so will I. I can see your heart in everything you've made. Every burning star, a signal fire of grace. If creation sings your praises, so will I. Yo sé promesas. Palabras fiel, tus dichos permanecerán. Cuando abre su boca, la vida y la ciencia siempre tu voz seguirán. Con solo hablar, le dice vida todo alrededor. Hace cada especie en su esplendor. Si ellos muestran quién tú eres, yo también puedo ver tu corazón en la creación. Cada amanecer un lienzo de tu amor. Si los cielos te obedecen, yo también. Stars were made to worship, so will I. If the mountains bow in reverence, so will I. If the oceans roar your greatness, so will I. For if everything it tis to leave you high, so will I. If the wind goes where your sand is, so will I. If the rocks cry out in silence, so will I. If the sum of all our praises still falls shy, you will sing again 100 billion times. And as you speak, 100 billion feelers disappear. Where you lost your life so I could find it here. If you left the great behind you, so will I. I can see your heart in everything you've done. Every part designed in a work of art called love. If you gladly show surrender, so will I. So will I. So will I.
Amen. I want to invite my friends, Tisha and Alisa, because we're gonna sing a scripture song. We were talking during our Sabbath school lesson about the many things that God does for us and that He's always with us. And the verse that we're gonna sing is Isaiah chapter 41, verses 10, 18, 9 and 13. So this is a known song for the students at Harbert Hills Academy. So guys, if you know this song, please sing with us. Isaiah 41, verses 18, 10 as our chorus, 9 and 13. I hope you guys can be blessed.
For I am with thee, oh, be not dismayed.
verse 13.
For I, the Lord thy God, I will hold thy right hand and say unto me, fear not, fear not, for I will help thee. Fear thou not, for I am with thee.
Now we're gonna have violin rendition by Eliakim and Jotham Desina, Shine on Us by Michelle Smith and Deborah Smith. This world is full of darkness as in the darkest night, and we need a light from the face of our Lord to light our way. It is full of wickedness, and we all need his grace to fall on us that we may be saved, so that we will have life. I hope you enjoy the song.
Thank you.
The next song is going to be Ride the Chariot. It says that this exciting traditional spiritual is both a statement of joy and plea of mercy with the coming of the revelation. Most often heard as a solo, this choral setting infuses gospel and jazz chord structure into the traditional spiritual genre, resulting in a melting pot of color influenced by the master of past and present. Hope you guys bless this.
Praise the Lord. Thank you so much, Anastasia, for the intro. The name of our choir is the name of our group is the Harbert Hills Academy Singing Men. And we did want to share, well, we wanted to share something with you. In Sabbath school, one of us mentioned a burden that was on our hearts, and I was so excited. We are so excited to see Sister Donna was here with us, praising God's name. We have another mic, if I guess, for you. And we were sharing to see you here with us. I'm going to ask if there are any visitors here other than our students. Are there any visitors that are here? I'm not going to ask you to do anything crazy. Okay, any visitors that we have here? Any visitors? Mr. Terry's not a visitor. So we're just, I'm encouraging. Hey, how are you? Good to see you, Hakima. I just want to remind you and all of us that Christ is coming soon, and this is a song that encourages us to be ready for Christ when he returns and for us to be ready to ride on the chariot as Elijah did to go to heaven.
I'm gonna ride in the chariot in the morning, Lord. I'm gonna ride in the chariot in the morning, Lord. I'm getting ready for the judgment day, my Lord, my Lord. I'm gonna ride in the chariot in the morning, Lord. I'm gonna ride in the chariot in the morning, Lord. I'm getting ready for the judgment day. My Lord, my Lord.
Are you ready, my brother?
Oh, yes.
Are you ready for your journey?
Oh, yes.
Do you want to see your Jesus?
Oh, yes. I'm waiting for the chariot because I'm ready to go. I'm going to ride in the chariot in the morning, Lord. I'm going to ride in the chariot in the morning, Lord. I'm getting ready for the judgment day. My Lord, my Lord.
Are you ready, my sister?
Oh, yes.
Are you ready for your journey?
Oh, yes.
Do you want to see your
Jesus? Oh, yes.
I'm waiting for the chariot because I'm ready to go.
Ride in the chariot to see my Lord.
When all my sins were taken away.
Ride in the chariot to see my Lord.
My feet were snatched from the miry clay.
Ride in the chariot to see my Lord.
I'll serve my Lord till judgment day.
Ride in the chariot to see my Lord.
I'm gonna ride in the chariot in the morning, Lord. I'm gonna
ride the chariot in the morning, Lord.
I'm getting ready for the judgment day.
My Lord, my Lord. Ride the chariot in the morning, Lord. Ride the chariot in the morning, Lord. I'm gonna ride in the chariot to see my Lord,
to see my Lord.
The song. Thank you for the song. It was really pretty. The song that we're gonna sing, that they're gonna sing right now, is "Press On." This song was composed by Bridget Smissor.
The song is telling us to press on till we reach the finish line. As we press on, we have a mission to accomplish and a battle to be won. We must run a race, and to complete this race, God will give us grace and strength as we press on to victory. Thank you. I wish you enjoy the song.
There's a course that must be finished. There's a race that must be run.
There's a mission to accomplish and a battle to be won. We have been called to take the challenge, but God's wider through His Son. He will give us grace to complete the race, moving forward, pressing on toward the hope of our high calling, toward the promise we receive, with the strength that will be given, pressing on to victory, and toward the one who's run before us, as we lay its way aside,
till the race is run.
Till the prize is won, till we reach the finish line, press on.
There's a faithful cloud of witnesses who inspire us in our task.
They have fought the fight.
They have run the race.
They have won the crown at last. And the lives they live remind us that though the race at times seems long, God will give the grace to complete the race and the courage to press on toward the hope of our high calling. Toward the promise we receive, with the strength that we've been given, pressing on to victory, and toward the one who's run before us, as he lays his way aside,
till the race is won,
till the prize is won, till we reach the finish line. Toward the hope of our high calling, toward the promise we receive, with the strength that we've been given, pressing on to victory, victory, and toward the one who's run before us, as we lay his weight aside.
Pretty song though. So our next song is gonna be Ocean, and it's gonna be sung by the male chorus. So the song serves as a reminder that just like Peter walking on the water toward Jesus in the biblical account, we are called to step out in faith and trust God's guidance. The lyric speaks of going where the feet may fail and being led deeper than my feet could ever wandered. It's encourage believers to let go on their fear and surrender to God's will, recognizing that He's capable of leading them to place their never thought possible.
this song reminds us that what we ever need now is to share the word of God with the world. It should be our purpose to spread the word unashamedly. We should desire to be a messenger of hope. We live in a dark world. The gospel is the light that everyone around us needs to see shining today. Thank you.
God, Heavenly Father, we praise you, O Lord, for the wonderful gift that you've given to our young people in singing. We praise you, O loving Father, for the time they spent to commit their for practicing, and also continue to be with us, O God, that these young people will to continue to serve you, to inspire your people in singing, and continue bless us as a church as we continue, as we wait for your coming to do the mission that we should be part of it. Thank you so much, O Lord, for loving us. This I ask in Jesus' name. Amen.